same way that I walked in. I want to be different. I want you to change me. I want you to change us. I want you to flood this house tonight, God. Spirit, you are welcome here.
To your heart, why should I be still when the worship starts, Lord? I'm so in love with you. What can man do? Can't hold me back anymore. And I'm after your heart, why should I be still when the worship starts, Lord? I'm so in love with you. What can man do? You can't hold me back anymore. Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you. Dance, dance, Holy Spirit in you. Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you.
Oh, I see some people starting to feel it. I'm after your heart, God. We're coming after you.
I'm after your heart. Why should I be still when the worship starts, Lord? I'm so in love with you. What can man do? They can't hold me back anymore. After your heart, why should I be still in the worship starts over? I'm so in love with you. What can man do? You can't hold me back anymore. Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you. Over me, and you are pleased when I spend myself on you. I'm gonna let go, really worship, letting my dance come forth.
Oh, who's ready to let it go tonight? Oh, come on now.
You spin over me, and you are pleased when I spend myself on you. I'm gonna let go, really worship, letting my dance come forth.
Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you. Dance, dance, Holy Spirit in you. Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you.
Over me, and you are pleased when I spit myself on you. I'm gonna let go and really worship, letting my dance come forth. You spin over me, and you are pleased when I spit myself on you. I'm gonna let go, really worship, letting my dance come forth.
Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you. Dance, dance, Holy Spirit in you. Dance, dance, let the Spirit move you. Dance, dance, Holy Holy Spirit in you.
Hallelujah.
You turn my morning into dancing. My heart is full of joy, and I will praise you.
Oh, come on now.
You turn my morning into dancing. My heart is full of joy. I will praise you.
Who's got some praise in them tonight? You turn my morning.
You turn my morning into dancing. My heart is full of joy. I will praise you.
You heal my body.
You heal my body. You made me new. My heart is full of joy, and I will dance for you.
Come on, let me see them feet moving.
You heal my body. You made me new. My heart is full of joy, and I will dance for you.
You gave me love.
You gave me love that broke down fear. My heart is full of joy, and I will sing to you.
I will sing, dance for you, for you, Jesus. And dance,
dance, let the Spirit move you.
Dance.
Holy Spirit in you, dance, dance. Let the Spirit move you,
dance,
dance. Holy Spirit in you, dance. Let the Spirit move.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God, you are here tonight. Holy Spirit, you are here tonight. Jesus. Jesus. You are worthy of glory tonight, God. You are worthy of honor tonight, God. You are worthy of our praise, God. Oh, Lord. From what you've done for us, God, from where we were to where we are, you deserve glory, honor, and praise. We are no longer the same people we were when we first met you. Thank you, God, for changing us. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You are good tonight. You are good every time, God. Always, God. Always, God.
Praying earlier before service, I just felt like God gave me this vision of this church, and I know that we're 16 years in the running, but I just felt like God said, we've already tied our shoes, and we've already stepped up to the line, and now the sound is coming, and we are almost ready to run, but the sound is coming, and it is almost here, and it is time to run. It is time to run. It is time to run.
Lifting one voice, you're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. And we will shout and proclaim the greatness of your holy name. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. We will stand and we will stand and rejoice as one people, lifting one voice. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. And we will shout and proclaim the greatness of your holy name. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. And you are holy.
sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. You are mighty. You are mighty. You are mighty. The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. We will stand and we will stand and rejoice as one people, lifting one voice. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. And we will shout and proclaim the greatness of your holy name. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. Cause you are holy. Cause you are holy. You are holy. The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. You are mighty. You are mighty. You are mighty. The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. Of your goodness, of your goodness, we will sing hallelujah to the King. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. And I'm redeemed from my past. I can say it at last. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. Of your goodness, of your goodness, we will shout hallelujah to the King. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. Who's redeemed? And I'm redeemed from my past. And I can stand here free at last. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. You are holy. Praise, oh God, you are mighty, you are mighty, you are mighty. The whole earth sings your praise, the whole earth sings your praise. You are holy, you are holy, you are holy. The whole earth sings your praise, the whole earth sings your praise. You are so deserving. We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. You pour out our best for you. We 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 pour out our best because you are.
Praise.
We're gonna sing.
rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love.
What is different about you? And it spreads from one person to the next, and then they catch fire. I can come over here to Brother Tim, and I light him on fire, and the next thing you know, he's on fire for God, he's on fire for the Lord, and then he'll go to Charlie, and Charlie's encouraged, and he's on fire, and pretty soon the whole building's on fire, and then the plaza's on fire, oh my, and then the city's on fire, and then the county's on fire, and then the state is on fire, all for the Lord. Wow. Wow. How many of you guys want to be a match tonight? How many want to be a match tonight? I don't know about y'all, but I want to be a match. I want to light some people on fire. I know that sounds horrible, but you know what I mean. I want to be that match that helps ignite people around me to show them the love of God, to show them that there's something better. There's no place I'd rather be than in that place. I don't want to sit in a bar. I don't want to sit ready to do drugs. I don't want to do that. I don't want to sit in front of my computer and look at things that I know I'm not supposed to be. There's no place I'd rather be than in his love. Because there's no place better. There is no place better. No place better. If you can find it, if you can find a place better, bring it to me. Because I guarantee you, you won't. If this is your heart's cry, we're going to sing it again. If this is your heart's cry, Lord, set a fire in my soul. Let him hear it. Don't just stand there. Don't just sit there and be like, let us fire. No. No. Come to him boldly. Come to him without meekness. Come to him without fear. He is your father. He is your daddy God. Have boldness going to the throne room. If that's your cry, I want you to sing it with everything you have in you. If you want to be the difference in your workplace, if you want to be the difference in your schools, if you want to be the difference in your own family, this be your cry. Set a fire in me that can't be contained. No place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd
would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I'd rather, well, tell them tonight. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be.
Master himself, Jesus, Son of the living God. The Bible says that he's the express image of God's person. He is an exact mirrored copy of God. Jesus left all that perfection to come to this earth to pay a price for you. He paid that price. He took that beating, the shame, the torture, the pain, death itself. Oh, but he didn't stay dead, did he? He rose on the third day, took the keys of death, hell, and the grave. But before he did all that, before he even came to this earth, before God ever even spoke the words, "Let there be light," he chose you.
Yes.
He picked hate you. He looked through time, through the ages. He saw you through the Spirit and he said, ah, yeah, that one's mine. We have been hand-picked. The book of Revelations talks about called, chosen, and faithful. Hallelujah. Lord, we say that we are a faithful church. We declare by faith right now that we are faithful. It is vitally important, your word tells us, that a steward be found faithful. Lord, if you're looking for us, you can find us in faithfulness. You can find us in faith. You can find us in love. You can find us in grace, in mercy, in the light. Lord, we walk in the light as you are in the light, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. We have been made clean by that price that the Lord Jesus has paid, and we celebrate it tonight. Lord God, have your way tonight in us, through us, and by us. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, be free to move among us. We open up our hearts. We ask you to open up our eyes and our ears that we may behold you greater than we even have expected. We put our expectation up there, but take us even higher tonight, Lord Jesus. And it's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Turn around, hug somebody, smile real big, tell them that you love them. Don't forget to smile. Let's make our way back to our seats. Brother Tim wants to testify real quick. Worship team, you may be seated. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to testify real quickly, and then I'll be done. Okay, so some of you know that I've been having some issues at my job. I've been there for 4 years. And I just felt like the Lord said it's time to call it quits, right? But I wanted to make sure that I was prepared first, right? And so I got two job interviews, and I went to both of them. One of them called me back for a second interview. I went to it, got the email today that I did not get that job. So I was like, okay, God, this is not your plan, right? This is not your plan. So I also, 2 years ago, I interviewed at Imagine School of Land O'Lakes, and they offered me the job, but I was unable to get out of my contract, right? So I called them, or I emailed them about a couple weeks ago, and they told me to come in today, and they hired me on the spot. So I'm really excited about that. And you know what's funny is that every time something really cool happens, rain follows me, okay? And did you know that just in that area at Land O'Lakes, the moment they offered me the job, it started raining? I just gotta say that. Praise the Lord, right? There you go.
Amen. That's a pretty good birthday present. Hey, I just have a couple of quick announcements before we receive tonight's offering and get into the Word. Number one, Pastor Brian and Sister Kim are not with us tonight. Sister Kim, of course, we didn't see her on Sunday either. I didn't ask Pastor today, but I guess she hadn't been to work since last Thursday. So, and then talking with Pastor today, he sounded much like a bullfrog, and I found out why. He was diagnosed with strep throat and pink eye.
Oh, wow.
So we've been praying and believing, and as a church family, we're standing together. You guys know it takes a lot for pastor to be here. He's not a hangnail kind of guy when it comes to not coming. Oh, I got a hangnail. I'm staying home from church. You know, a pastor stays home from church. So let's be praying and standing and believing for healing for pastor and for Sister Kim. They're getting ready to go to Virginia Beach here in a couple days, as long as everything's doing better. So let's pray that total and complete healing so they can continue on to their planned trip. Praise God. The other announcement I have is an extremely important announcement. Can anybody tell us what next Thursday is, a week from tomorrow?
National Day of Prayer.
National Day of Prayer. We will be meeting with a number of other churches and ministries and believers on City Hall steps right over here. Let me just tell you guys, don't miss this opportunity. We get one opportunity a year to meet on City Hall steps. There are a number of cities and countries on this planet that couldn't even imagine doing that without getting shot, without getting arrested, without never seeing your family again. And the last couple of years, there's been some pretty good turnouts. Let's surpass it this time. Brother Wayne has the privilege to pray. Pastor Brian's going to be out of town, so I have the privilege to pray. There's going to be a number of other, there's going to be worship, and there's going to be, you know, maybe some dramas or something. I don't know. All I know is what I'm doing. But I know it's going to be good, and I know that we shouldn't be missing out on this opportunity. It's at 6:30, is it? 7 o'clock? We'll get the time for you. But whatever time it is, it's 6:30 to 8 o'clock, right over on City Hall steps, right outside. Amen? Well, it is time to receive our tithes and offerings tonight, but God laid a scripture on my heart today out of Proverbs chapter 11, if you'd turn there with me. Proverbs chapter 11. And I also want to read this out of the Amplified Bible in my phone. No, I'm not texting from the pulpit. Proverbs chapter 11, and let's read verses 24 and 25. There is that scattereth, or there is one that scatters and yet increases, and there is one that withholds more than is meet, but tends to poverty. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that waters shall also be watered himself. Let me read. That's a little King Jamesy, don't you think? Let me read it in the Amplified. Verse 24, it says, there is one who generously scatters abroad, yet increases all the more. And there is one who withholds what is justly due, but it results only in want and poverty. Verse 25 says, the generous man is a source of blessing and shall be prosperous and enriched. But he who waters will himself be watered, reaping the generosity he has sown. Hallelujah. It seems like a little echoey. Is Kristen, sound girl Kristen, making a... I feel like I'm talking in a canyon. This is epic. It's an epic offering teaching tonight. For an epic harvest.
Amen.
There's one that scatters, yet somehow, even though they are giving out, is somehow still increasing more. And there's the one that's trying to be stingy and hang on to everything they got, yet they still find themselves in lack and poverty. Then there's the guy that he's watering, he's giving out his waters, and yet somehow his cistern is all the way full, is always full. The universal law of sowing and reaping. Even the non-believer, they call it karma. They call it in, you know, do goods and paying it forward. We know that it is a kingdom law that whatsoever we sow, that shall we reap. And it's not just something we do because we're supposed to. It's in the bylaws of the church, and if you want to join, you made a covenant that you're going to give tithes here. Oh, no. We know that when we're generous, it is sown back to us good measure. Pressed down. Shaken together and running over. You know, that's not a... You know, we hear these verses sometimes, and they can become slogans for us. They can become sayings for us. But imagine you're going... Imagine you're the one sowing at the block party. We've had the opportunity to do this. And they come up with the bag, and we're getting ready to fill it with some clothes. And they've got it full. We got it good measure. Oh, you need some more than that. Press it down some more. We can get some more on top of that bag. Oh, there's still a little bit more room in there. Shake it around a little bit. We can still get a little bit more in that bag. Now and in the end, it is still running over with blessing. We have sown generously. We will reap generously. Maybe I'll tell this testimony again. You know, I'm preaching a lot in the next couple of weeks while pastors allegedly going to be out of town. But I just can't wait to, I was going to wait to testify this in front of the whole church. And I'm not saying this on me. I'm saying this on God. We know that we all have had an opportunity to be able to sow in to provide a roof for the Gilman family in the church. And praise God, God laid an amount on my heart to be able to give. And I talked about it with Kristen. And God also had gave her the exact same amount that we were supposed to sow into that. And I'm not going to tell you what the amount is, but it was a generous amount for us. It wasn't a, you know... We found some coins in the couch kind of seed that we were sowing into the Gilmans. So we had it on our heart. We sowed that seed on a Sunday. On that next Monday, that very next day, I came up here. And Pastor and I were meeting with a couple different people for some things. And I get done with that meeting. I get in the car and I call Kristen. And Kristen told me we got a 4 times harvest. In the day, we got a 4 times, $1, $4. That's what 4 times, 4 times the amount we sowed, we got back in harvest. So Kristen's telling me this, and I just pulled out of the parking lot, and Pastor calls me on the other line. I had just left Pastor less than 2 minutes before this. I hadn't even gotten, you know, down past Wendy's or anything like that. So I click over and I say, Pastor, do you think I can have a testimony in the 2 minutes since I've left you? Yes, I can. And told him the testimony, and praise God. This is something that I'm not just preaching because I'm getting a kickback. I'm getting 5% on whatever the offering is today. No, this is something I believe because it is something that I know. I would not preach this up here if it is not something that I do. I can assure you, Pastor Brian would not let me preach this up here, and if it was not something that I do, amen? So let's stand to our feet. Let's get ready to give. Let's get ready to give in generosity, but don't forget to give in faith. Hallelujah. Charlie, would you pray for the offering tonight? Amen. Let's bring our tithes and offerings. Amen. Well, if you guys have your Bibles tonight, go over with me to the book of Colossians. The book of Colossians, chapter 2. Colossians, chapter 2, and we're going to start reading at verse 5. But let's have a word of prayer before we dig into the Word. Lord, we come into agreement right now as a church body, as a church family, and we release our faith for utterance. We release our faith for ears that hear, for eyes that see, and for a heart that discerns. Lord God, open up your word to us. That every single one of us, God, as you know, have things that are going on in our lives, and there is answers in your word that give light, and that light shines the way to victory. Show us that light tonight so that we can be overcomers indeed, so that we will know the truth and that truth will make us free. And we thank you for it. We praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 5, it said, this is the Apostle Paul speaking. He says, "For though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ." The steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Steadfastness of faith. Would you say that with me? Steadfastness of faith. To be steadfast means to be firm. It means to be strong. It means to be solidified. In the context of a steadfast faith, it means that we have the having done all stand endurance attached to our faith. It's the faith that I am going to stand and I am going to keep on standing. I am going to outlast any bad report, any adversity, anything that would try to contradict the end result of the promise of God. I am going to keep on keeping on until I experience the end result of whatever that promise is that we're believing. And the Apostle Paul is saying to the church at Colossae, he's saying, I may not be with you in person, but by the Spirit I see it. He's rejoicing at this immovable, unshakable faith of that church. Now, if we want to have a steadfast faith, there is two elements that we need to have in it. Strength and endurance. Strength and, don't forget the and, endurance. These two elements working together. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews chapter 6, it says, don't be slothful, but be followers of them who through faith and, that Christian cuss word, patience, inherit the promises. How many want to inherit a promise? How many got a promise of God, a word of God in your life that you want to inherit? Is it just faith that you need? No, there's something else that you need with it. Patience. Faith in the word of God is where we get the strength. Patience is where we get that endurance. Those two need to be joined together. Yeah. I read a book just recently that was called Faith and Patience, The Power Twins. Put those two together. You know, because you can have the strongest faith around. Faith so strong that it can move mountains, that it's firmly established in the Word of God. But if you don't have that endurance with it, somehow, some way, you'll be overtaken by some scheme of the enemy. Yeah. It's like these professional boxers that are first round knockout artists. That when the fight starts and ding ding, the bell rings, they're coming at you with everything they got. They're head hunting. They're going for that one shot knockout. But if you can make it through, but if their opponent can make it through the first round, maybe the first two rounds, that big old puncher is going to get full of doubt. He's going to get frustrated. He's going to get careless, and he's going to make a mistake eventually that he's going to get caught and eventually get knocked out. Not just strong, but there's got to be that endurance to be able to outlast the attacks of the enemy. Because Satan comes immediately to make a move against you standing out in faith. Persecution and affliction arises for the word's sake. Just because that word has been sown, Satan is going to try to bring some kind of pain, some kind of pressure against you to try to steal that word and to steal your faith and in the end, steal your victory. You know, imagine we're in here and, you know, there's an altar call and you come up front and pastor lays hands on you and anointed with oil and elders lay hands and you go down to the Spirit and all these things and you get up full of faith. And there's the devil waiting, looking through the back window going, oh, look at you. Big chief faith believer. I got something for you. And he gets his Rolodex, his flip file out, and he's going through the, oh, here's what got him last time. And if I remember right, this is what got him the six times before that, too. Be assured that whatever thing you fell to last time, why would he come up with something new when he knows that's what got you the last time? It is going to be the exact same attack, just repackaged in another way. What he's counting on is I'm going to come in with that pain. I'm going to come in with something, a bad kind of suddenly, and cause you to get off your faith and quit. That's the end of that. But it's with the steadfastness of faith that we have the wherewithal, the endurance, and the strength and power to be able to outlast the attack of the enemy and move on toward victory and overcoming. Amen? Let's read the next verse. Verse 6, it says, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. The word Christ in this verse is referring directly to Jesus the Anointed One and his anointing. Now let me, just to make sure, I'm sure most of you, if not all of you, know this, but let me just mention this to make sure we're all pointed in the same direction. The book of Isaiah chapter 10 says that burdens are removed and yokes are destroyed because of the anointing. The anointing is the burden-removing, yoke-destroying power of God. Now, there is a time that you received Jesus. We have received Jesus as our Savior. Let me tell you that it is also a good thing to receive Him as your Lord. There is also a time where it is time to receive the anointing. You know, a lot of people, Jesus is their Lord, Jesus is their Savior, but they have not received the power to go along with it. They have not received the power to have yokes and burdens taken away and destroyed out of their life. There is a time for the anointing to be received. There's also a time for the anointing to be walked in. As you have received, so walk in it. There's a time for the receiving of the word. There's a time for impartation. There's a time to be poured into. Oh, but there's another time where it's time to walk in it. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. There is a time. Receiving denotes taking it in. Walking in it means that you are living it. It is not, you're just not receiving it. It is coming out. Hallelujah. That it's not. Jesus with the disciples, he called them, they received that call. Amen? They followed him everywhere that he went. They're hearing the every message that he taught. Not only do they get to hear the message, they get to go back to and sit around the campfire with them at night. And they can ask him all these questions about the same message and be taken further. He's around them while he's doing the miracles, and they're right there seeing everything that he's doing. They're learning. They're getting details. They're receiving all these things from the Lord Jesus. But there came a time where they were supposed, Jesus had an expectation that they were going to walk in it. Remember when they were out on the boat? Jesus went to bed on purpose, on a pillow. He just didn't happen to fall asleep. He went and got himself a pillow, and even when the boat was filling up with water, there was Jesus sloshing around, but he's still laying on his pillow. The disciples said, "Oh, Jesus, we're going to die." Jesus got up, rebuked the wind, declared peace. The storm went away and turned around to them and said, "Hey, where's your faith?" Jesus had an expectation that it wasn't receiving time, it was walking in time. But they did learn a lesson. Thank God. If you're making a lot of mistakes, oh, thank you, Lord. The disciples made them too. We got hope too. There was another time where Jesus sent them out. Pastor talked about it on Sunday. 2 by 2. And they came back and said, "Jesus, people got set free. Jesus, even the devils were subject to your name." They did walk in it. They took what they had received, that anointing that they had received in their own life, and they stepped into it. They walked in it and they stepped out into it. Hallelujah. Let's keep reading. You know, in our own lives, you can come up here. Prophet of God's in town. Pastor prophesies something. You're going to the nations. You're going to preach to the thousands. You're going to go and do and be and all these wonderful things. And you receive that word, but for you to experience the fullness of it, somehow, some way, it comes a time where you're going to have to walk in that word that God's put in your life. Amen? Next verse. Verse 7, it says, "Rooted and built up in Him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving." We see these same elements in this verse. There's a time for receiving and there's a time for walking in. As you have been taught. There's a time for teaching and pouring into. The seed of the Word of God is planted on the inside of us. That seed, hallelujah, takes root in the good ground of our heart, or it should. And then there is a time where that built up happens. Well, I'm thinking of one of my favorite chapters in the whole Bible, Psalm chapter 1. It says, "And we'll be like a tree, planted, rooted by the rivers of water, brings forth fruit in our season. The leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever you do will prosper." Oh, man, I can't stand those prosperity preachers. David. You can't stand prosperity preachers? Throw Jesus out and throw David out of the whole book. Amen? Don't mean to get into your doctrine. Rooted and built up. A fruit-bearing tree. What's a tree that's built up? It's grown up. There's fruit that's coming off of it. And it's going to come to the place where it is abounding. Abound, the verse that was up there. Abounding. Now, abounding is, it's a word, if you start to look up some of the translations, super abounding. It's an explosive type of word. Think about it in the context of a tree that's abounding. Think about it. Jesus, when he was telling the parable of the, was talking about the mustard seed, and he said it starts off as the smallest of the seeds, and it grows up to the greatest of the herbs, and it's this big tree that the birds can come lodge in. Yeah, amen. The fruit of the tree isn't just for the tree. when it abounds out, that fruit can be partaken of by others. It should be partaken of by others. There's a, when we first moved into our house, our neighbors have a beautiful backyard. They've got a bunch of fruit trees in their backyard. Well, right on the fence line is this lime tree. And when the nice neighbors, we like them. They said, any limes that grow over your side of the fence, you can have. Well, hallelujah. I'm thinking, what can we do to get more leaves? Just wait a little bit. That first year, we got two or three. This is, I think, our third year. When Kristen said a few months back, go get a lime. We had some people over or something like that. She said, go get a lime. There was more than we could use that had grown over on our side of the fence. Hallelujah. In the same way, it had abounded where not just neighbor people are partaking of the fruit of that tree. Now it has abounded over on our side of the fence so that we can partake of that tree. And that's how it should be in our own life, where there is that walking in and walking out and stepping out, that abounding that has taken place where... Yeah, it'll be that you can agree with people in faith. Yeah, it'll be that you can lay hands on the sick and have a part and have an influence over people's life. But that influence will even extend with just you being around them. There's certain people in my life that, just being around them brings me up higher. Just being around them. You know, you have a week or something like that where you slept in and you didn't spend time in the Word and you messed up a little bit and you're just feeling icky. Yeah. But you get around somebody, you might not even tell them, but just being there with them has brought you up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The fruit is being partaken of. The sphere of influence, that spirit on the inside of us, it is steadfastly abounding. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, next verse. Verse 8, it says, beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of this world, and not after Christ. Is this scripture? Yeah. It's the same. I mean, this several verses before this, it's the same scripture that we love. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Talking about steadfastness of faith. Talking about being rooted and built up. But it's also saying beware. Is it possible for us to get carried away? Is it possible for us to be despoiled here? It's talking about, it's not talking about spoiled milk. It's talking about spoiled like the treasure that a stolen treasure of a pirate. That in fact, if you look up the Greek translation, it says booty. I think that's the first time I've said booty on from the pulpit. It says it's talking about taking away like pirate's booty. Look it up. I'm telling the truth. Boy, those Greeks, they had some good translations. Spoiled by philosophy. The title of this message, in fact, is faith or philosophy? Faith or philosophy? Back up a little bit to verse 4. We didn't read this as we were getting started. Verse 4 in this same chapter says, and this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. You do a word study on that word beguile. What it means is to be deceived by logic. Can we be deceived by logic? Yes. Can enticing words draw us away from the things of God? Yeah. Look on Facebook. 49% of the internet memes. Those thingies. Those pictures with words on them. They have words on it. Sound profound. That sound logical. That it, or you'll get these articles. Everybody and their mammy's got a blog these days, and they got a title in front of their name and a PhD in the back of their name. And oh man, they really seem like what they know what they're talking about. And every single one of their 16 points that go against the Word of God made sense. But the bottom line is it went against the Word of God.
That's right.
But we can be beguiled by the logic, because the words made sense, because they were based in logic, they were based in reason, they might even be based in altruism, which would be like a worldly kind of compassion, but it's ungodly. Philosophy is a fondness for wisdom, a love of wisdom. Now you might be thinking, doesn't the Bible say to get wisdom? Isn't there a whole book written by the wisest man that ever walked the earth about wisdom that says get wisdom, cherish it above gold and fine gold and rubies and jewelry and all these things? Well, what's wrong with being a lover of wisdom? Godly wisdom. There is more than one type of wisdom.
Yes.
Let's go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 20. Is this okay, guys?
Yeah.
1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, it says, where's the wise? Don't you just love it? Paul always asks all these good questions. Where's the wise? Where's the scribe? Where's the disputer or the reasoner of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by its, it says by wisdom or by its own wisdom, knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after what? Wisdom. In verse 20 and 21, the Apostle Paul talks about the two different kinds of wisdom. There's the world's wisdom, and then there's God's wisdom. Now let's go down a few verses and let's see the difference between the two. Verse 27. But God has chosen what? The foolish thing. Oh man, he picked me. I've been chosen. Oh, hallelujah. He chose the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the things which are mighty. The base things of the world, the things which are despised has God chosen. Yea, the things which are not, to bring to naught or to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. Now, it's not by chance that Paul is saying this to the church at Corinth. Anybody know what country Corinth is in? Greece. Corinth, if you look, it's a city that exists even now today. If you can ask Siri where Corinth is, it's probably like an hour to hour and a half drive from Athens. It would be like in Florida, it's like the distance from here to Sarasota, or the distance from here to Orlando, or the distance from here to Spring Hill, Brooksville type of thing. What are the Greeks known for? Socrates. Remember him? Socrates. Plato. Guys that are spewing a whole bunch of philosophy and wisdom, and it all sounds good. It all makes sense. It is logical. It is based in this profound thought. That's what, and Paul's saying this to the church at Corinth because they can get caught up in all this wisdom stuff. Paul was at Athens before he went. If you look this up, we don't have time to read it, but it is. It's a good story in the book of Acts, I think it's Acts chapter 17, that it's talking about Paul, you know, he went into some different cities. Of course, they won some people to the Lord and got kicked out every single place he went. And he ended up in Athens, and he's walking around, and he sees that the whole city had given themselves over to idolatry. Well, he starts kind of preaching a little bit, and the Bible says that the whole city of Athens, their primary thing that they loved was to either talk about or hear about something new. Some new philosophy. Some new wisdom. We need to be cautious as believers that we don't turn into Christian philosophers. That having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. One of the main things about Christian philosophers is it's always that receiving in, but it's never the walking in. Remember we just talked, there's the receiving in time, then there's the walking in time. Remember the book of James talks about being doers of the word? And if we are hearers, James 1:25 says we will deceive our own selves. What do Christian philosophers do? They deceive their own self. They're always looking after something new, just like those Greeks do. In Acts chapter 17, the whole city is only after something new. I was just listening to a message today, and I've heard this story from this man of God before, but it bears repetition, that he was teaching at Rhema Bible College in their healing school. And he was, after the service, ministering to this man one day, and the man's coming up to ask for healing, and he said, well, you know, the Bible says in Matthew 8:17, himself bore your sicknesses and carried your disease. And this man said, sonny boy, I've been knowing that scripture since your mama had you in diapers. And this man of God says, you know, he'd thinking to himself, God, I need another scripture. I need to learn some more stuff so I can give something to this guy that he hasn't heard before. And later on, after that encounter that didn't work out so hot, obviously the guy didn't get healed. After that encounter, later on, God said, he doesn't need another scripture. He doesn't believe the things that I've already told him. Here's this guy wanting healing. Here's this guy came to healing school. He's coming to the man of God to get healed. Already knew the power that he needed was contained in Jesus bore your sicknesses and carried your diseases. By his stripes, he were healed. The power to experience the healing, more than enough, was found in those verses. But he was looking for something new. Thought he was in faith, but he was a philosopher. Another thing that we need to guard against in this. Well, let me hang on to that just for a second. Going into same book here into the chapter 2, verse 4, it says, this is Paul still speaking, he says, and my speech and my preaching was not with the enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Hallelujah. Demonstration means manifestation. It was coming out. Hallelujah. Verse 5 says, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in what? The power of God. Hallelujah. Not standing in logic and reasoning and the receiving in of head knowledge, but in the outward power of the Word of God. Hallelujah. That our faith isn't just based in, oh, really, that's good. That's good. I never heard that before. Oh, man, I heard that revelation. What Pastor Caleb has said at times, people are hungry for wordplay. You get something and you say it in some sing-songy, rhymey way, I guarantee you get an amen. May not be scriptural, but oh man, you know, if the glove don't fit, you must have quit. Oh, amen, you know, just because it sounds good. That our faith isn't standing just in something that makes sense, hallelujah, but in the power of God. Go over to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Verse 11, very familiar verse. And he gave to some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. For what? For the perfecting. Oh man, I got a title now. I've made it. But for what's the purpose of it? For what? I'll never forget, and you guys have heard me say this before, and I'll say it again. It's not part of the message, but it bears repetition. When I was first taking over leadership of the block party, it was when Pastor Dave was getting ready to go to his church, and on Tuesday nights, I'm meeting over in the children's church area with Pastor Brian and Pastor Dave, and we're doing all this block party stuff. Well, praise God, it comes to the block party time. Block party's over, getting ready to send Pastor Dave out. We were driving all this way from New Tampa. I'm thinking, oh man, thank God I don't need to spend all that gas driving there every Tuesday night. And Pastor says, why don't you keep coming on the Tuesday nights? You know, just for time together. Thus was born the leadership class. And I'm just so excited. You know, here I am getting poured into by the man of God, getting to spend time with Pastor and this on Tuesday nights. And that first night, I was on the way home. I was just getting toward making the last turn in New Tampa to get home. The Holy Ghost spoke to my heart and said, I'm not raising you up to lead the people. I'm raising you up so the people can be led. Puts things in perspective. It ain't about you. It's about the people. It is about you. God makes it about you. We'll get blessed too. But our purpose of being raised up and called and chosen and all these things isn't so that, oh man, because who knows where the kingdom of God would be without me? No, it's so the people can be led. Hallelujah. For what? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of faith. Into the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, or unto a full-grown, mature man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. I taught on to the young adults this month. What are we measuring to? We have all had faith experiences. And there's a saying that I don't necessarily like, but you'll know what I mean when I say it. We've all had faith failures. Maybe it's not our faith that failed it. We thought we were in faith, and maybe we were in something else. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I'm the only one. No hands raised? I'm the only one that's ever, you know. Bill raised his hand. Thank you, Bill. And with something we perceived as faith, but maybe it wasn't, and we thought God should have moved in a certain time frame or a certain way or one thing or another. If things don't turn out like we planned, we can begin to build doctrines around those experiences. And we can, even beside the word doctrine per se, we can begin to filter future faith endeavors through the eyes of that experience. Where now our vision is no longer measuring. Pastor talks about the measuring reed, where it's no longer measuring up to the fullness of the stature of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now that experience has narrowed our measuring. Where inadvertently we can have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof because we got hurt, because we think God didn't come through like it. This is the real stuff. Like this, that we can begin to see God through these things. It didn't work out last time, so that must be how God moves. And the measuring of our faith becomes more narrow, and we experience less of the power. The Bible talks about with what measure you meet, or with what measure you measure, it will be measured back to you. and it becomes a perpetual self-fulfilling cycle that God moved that way again. I tried to believe again, and we're saying the scriptures, we're doing the steps, we're doing all the things you need to do, but our real heart believing, not the steps, but the way we believe in our heart, the way we expect, is still in that narrow thing. We're philosophers. And even when people talk about it, well, you know, sometimes, by his stripes you're healed. Well, always when you hear that, well, oh man. Stand up here during prayer time sometimes. You'll hear some, well, you'll hear some stuff. I'll leave it at that. And I'm not talking bad about anybody, because it is a subtle deception. And it'll be based on reasoning. It'll be based on logic. And believe me, I don't know the answers on why a faith failure happened, but always, the last thing that people look at, which should really be the first thing we look at, is where did I miss it? Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Yeah, there might be a reason. Yeah, there might be this, there might be that. But don't go for that big, profound, philosophical reason. Look here first. God, what did I do? He may tell you. You may just know I missed it. Kristen and I were talking about something from a couple years ago that oh man, we thought it was it. We were headed in this direction. We missed it. I don't know how. I don't know where. I do know where, but I don't know how it happened. We thought we were in faith, but it was something else. But I've got my measuring stick, and I'm not measuring up against a letdown. I'm measuring it up against this. There is a fullness of the stature that I want to measure up to. Hallelujah. And I'm going to be steadfast in my... I wish I had a yardstick up here, because a ruler won't do. A little tape measure won't do. You got to have something big, you know. Is there a big stick or something like that? Give me something big to hang on. Give me a broom or something. We're measuring up with the fullness of the stature of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm not going, you know, my experience last time. Lord, can you... I know you're able, but God, I know sometimes we're at 6 or 8 inch faith. Oh, yeah. We got a telescope in one. There's a fullness. If only Pastor were here now. Okay, I'm measuring up because this is where I was at last. This might have been just the test, that you only got this experience because your faith was just at that point before. You were just getting started before. Or it could be this wasn't even the end of the result. This was just first the blade, then the ear, then this was the full corn in the ear. But where'd my pen go? You stopped at the little thing, oh, God didn't come through, oh, blah, blah, blah. That was just the blade. Yeah. Yeah. The steadfastness of faith. Boy, I feel like a champion. The steadfastness of our faith is what measures up against that measuring reed that is massive. That's the fullness of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is that measuring reed that David used when he measured up against that big boy and knocked him out. He wasn't measuring up against the armor, and he's got that fence post spear and all those big old things that he's got. He's saying, no, I got a covenant with the living God, and that is what I lay on, and that is what I'm going to be measuring up to. Well, you know, well, sometimes guys like that, they might get you. Oh, no. That's what logic says. That's what Saul says when he's like, You better take my armor to go out there. No. That armor is untested, but the covenant is. Hallelujah. The word of God is tested. Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet. Hallelujah. There, faith or philosophy? And guys, we could have just camped out on the one point the whole time. Don't let the simplicity of this escape you. Don't let It can't be overstated. There's a time for receiving the word. There can be a season for receiving the word. There is also a time for walking in it. That even in the adversity where I don't feel very healed, I don't feel very anointed, I don't feel that my marriage is okay, I don't feel like the situation's turning around, I don't feel like I'm going to get a call from somebody offering me a job today. But you walk in that anointing, hallelujah. You walk in that power of the burden-removing, yoke-destroying power of God. Attack. There's going to be an adversity. There's going to be something that Satan himself will try to bring your way. He's sending somebody specifically for you with an attack that's specifically designed for you because it made you fall the last time. I pray that you recognize the attack. And the attack may not come with a broom, a javelin, you know, some big, a big giant. The attack might come with that pen, with that experience, with what happened last time. And when that happens, that's when it's time to take out this measuring reed and say, oh man, I gotta measure up some more. God, I might have not measured up as much as I should have last time. I might have fell last time. I might have not measured up at all. But I'm coming closer. Okay, come out here, Charlie. You got to pick the tallest one to measure up to. My kids are getting a little bit bigger now. And my grandma's, I think, 4'11 or something like that. So I think Abigail's 4'6. So when we saw them this weekend, Abigail's going, I'm as tall as, and of course she's doing this with her hand. I'm as tall as Grammy is now. I'm as tall. No, she's not measuring up to Grammy's height before, but she's getting close.
You got a ways to go
there. Measure up to the fullness of the step. And let me just read this just as we close here, this last part that we want to read in Colossians chapter 2. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and we are complete in him. I've got a lack. I'm not good enough in this area. I always fall in this area. I do this. I just stop looking at you and walk in that completeness that is only found in him. Lord, I pray for your people. I pray for eyes that see attacks. Holy Ghost, you show us things to come. One of your main jobs is that you show us things to come. You are preparing us even tonight for the attack. But Lord, we dig our heels in the ground. Hallelujah. We do everything to stand, and then we keep on standing. Lord, your word tells us to resist the devil, and he will flee. Devil, you can't have an unlimited attack because God said you'll flee. So we outlast you, hallelujah. By the blood of the Lamb, by the word of our testimony, and by steadfastness of faith, not philosophy. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You are dismissed.